Bismillah, walhamdulillah, wassalatu wassalamu upon Rasulullah and the members of his family, and Allah be pleased with those who followed his pathway in great guidance till the day of judgment. Ameen. My dear sisters and my brothers, as usual, this is your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. In this first installment in the Underlying Reasons series, I will discuss one of the arguments that is at the foundation of what the men of religion, aka scholars of Islam or seekers of knowledge, answer every time they are faced with an issue where wives or daughters or women in general in Islam are concerned. In this first installment, I will uncover the thinking behind what the men of religion truly believe in and why they give those answers that belittle women the way they do it. There is a history, or there is a story of a great scholar in Islam, and I will tell you first a story, then I will, inshallah, end up with uncovering the truth behind it. It is narrated, or this is a story told, that a great man, a very popular scholar of Islam, one day took two of his friends and he said to them, "Come with me, we are going to see a woman." They went down, and at one point they sat in between two walls, and then the man, this great man, left these people behind him and he went through and met a woman in a place, in a house there. It is reported that this man said to the woman, "Give yourself up to me." And then the woman answered negatively. Then the man wanted to touch the woman, put his hand on her to calm him down because she was agitated and she was just nervous and stressed out. And then the woman said to him, "A'udhu billahi mink, I seek refuge in Allah from you." And then this man, the great scholar, apparently accepted this from the woman and he left. Now, I want you to imagine for a second here that this man was your husband, or was you, my brother, or anyone that you know is pious. Any scholar of Islam today, let's take any great scholar today, would he go and enter on a woman and tell her, "Give yourself up to me"? Why would she want to give herself up to him? And then he would, when she says no, then he would stretch his hand to put it on her to calm her down because he noticed that she was agitated and she was nervous and trembling. Does that really register with how our teachings of Islam are? Well, here is the true story. So this story is used by our scholars to show the superiority of the male over the female. If that great scholar or if that great man of religion did that, behave that way, then hey, we can also behave this way. Now the problem gets even tougher when this man in question is the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You'll be surprised that this story is actually said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam went to a woman and he was with her in a great garden isolated from the eyes of other people, and he told her, "Give yourself up to me." And the woman said no. And then it is reported, and I don't believe in this story 100%, I don't believe it. And then it is said that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam stretched his hand to put his hand on the woman to calm her down. And only Allah knows where he was going to put that hand. On her shoulder, on her arms, where? But anyway, you might think, come on, brother, what did you read this story? Well, you'll be surprised that this story is reported in Al-Bukhari and in Muslim, amongst other books, because there is also Musnad Ahmed ibn Hanbal, and there is also Tabaqat ibn Sa'd and Al-Hakim al-Mustadrik of Al-Hakim. So this story is famous in the books of Hadith, and here are the particularities of this story, and then I will tell you where the scholars get their rulings out of it. Al-Bukhari, Allah have mercy on his soul, the number of his hadith is 5,254, who reports it on the authority of Al-Imam Al-Awza'i, one of great scholars of hadith. And then he said that one man asked Al-Zuhri, which of the Prophet's wives sought refuge in Allah from him? Now look at the question here. It was not a woman. He says the wives. So in this hadith here by Al-Bukhari, the woman is already a wife. And then he said, أخبرني عروة, a man called Urwa, who is a member of the family of our mother Aisha radiallahu anha, that our mother Aisha is the teller of the story, not the woman, not the whoever, but is the wife of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. أن ابنة الجوني, the daughter of الجوني, لما أدخلت على رسول الله, when she was brought in as a bride to the messenger of Allah. And I want you to keep these words in your mind. Here she was brought in as a bride to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, because in the other ahadith, we are going to see the contradictory statements, and this is why this story does not stand at all. But in any way, so when she was brought in as a bride, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam dana minha, he approached her, obviously for sexual connection. She said to him, قالت أعوذ بالله منك. She said, I have sought refuge with Allah against you. Subhanallah. If she is already a bride, that means she has accepted the marriage. She has. Why would she say that? But anyway, let's carry on with the story. فقال لها, and then he said to her, صلى الله عليه وسلم, لقد عذت بعظيم, you have sought refuge with a great magnificent one, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ألحقي بأهلك, go back to your family, meaning he divorced her, صلى الله عليه وسلم. And straight away, even in this statement, when he told her, leave your house, that was the first divorce. The Quran explicitly says in Surah Talaq, لَا تُخْرِجُهُنَّ مِن بُيُوتِهِنَّ, do not chase them away from their houses. As you can see in this story, the behavior, the act of Rasulullah contradicts the command of Allah. And this is impossible. Allah has, it's impossible. Rasulullah didn't tell a woman, leave my home, go to your parents. And you can see here how men have played on this hadith so that they will say, you see, when Rasulullah divorced that woman, he told her, go back to your family. And this is a huge lie. It is impossible. A man that Allah has said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ, you certainly have the highest degree that any human can reach of morals, characteristics, and behavior would behave like this. It is impossible that Rasulullah would disobey a direct command of Allah in Al-Quran. It is impossible. But you can see here, the hadith already has its issues. Let's go on now. In another hadith, reported also by Al-Bukhari, this hadith's number is the one right before this one, and it is 5,254. The other one is 5,254, and this one is 5,255. Abi Usaydin radiallahu, this man's name is Abi Usayd. He's going to tell us now another version of the story. خرجنا مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم, we went out with the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, حتى انطلقنا إلى حائط يقال له الشوط, till we got to a garden called الشوط, that's the name of the garden, حتى انتهينا إلى حائطين, and then they walked again until they found two walls, فجلسنا بينهما, two facing walls, maybe within the big garden, there are also separated gardens, and the walls of the two other gardens were there, so they sat in between these two gardens. فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم اجلسوا هاهنا, so the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said to them, remain here, sit down here and wait in between these two walls. ودخل, and then the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم entered the ashout, the big garden where he wanted there. And in that big garden there was a small house, a small maybe one bedroom or whatever it is. And then the hadith says, وَقَدْ أُوتِيَ بِالْجَوْنِيَّةِ, and he was brought, the woman Al-Jawniyah was already brought up, and she was into that house. And that house was within a date palm garden. And that woman's name was Umayma bint Nu'man ibn Sharahil. And then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam went to her, and that woman had one of her servants with her. It is said, because I do not agree with this 100%, when the Prophet ﷺ, فَلَمَّا دَخَلَ عَلَيْهَا النَّبِيُّ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ, when the Prophet ﷺ entered upon her into the house, so there was, I want you to picture this, a woman sat there, and there is another hadith will explain to us how she was sat. She was sat with her head down, and she was very tense. And the Prophet ﷺ enters then. There was this woman, there was her servant there, and the Prophet ﷺ. What did Rasulullah said to her? Straight here. No salamu alaikum. No how are you doing. No introduction of himself. He only uttered three words. Habi nafsaki li. Give yourself up to me. I want you, my sister, imagine this. A man comes onto you, tells you, give yourself up to me. What does that mean? قالت. So the lady answered back, وَهَلْ تَهَبُ الْمَلِكَةُ نَفْسَهَا لِلسُّوقَ. She answered back, and would a queen give herself up to a valueless, ordinary man? That's how she qualified Rasulullah, a valueless, ordinary man. فقال. So the narrator says, فَأَهْوَى بِيَدِهِ يَضَعَ يَدَهُ عَلَيْهَا لِتَسْكُنْ. So he stretched out his hand to put it on her to calm her down. It's impossible Rasulullah would do these things, but anyway, let's carry on. And then she said, أَعُوذُ بِاللَّهِ مِنْكْ. I seek refuge in Allah from you. She was more pious in her behavior than the Prophet ﷺ. He wanted to offer yourself to me. She responds back very tough, as the Quran says, حَتَّى لَا يَطْمَعَ الَّذِي فِي قَلْبِهِ مَرَضْ. لا تخضعنا بالقول. Do not submit in the way you talk, so that anyone who has a disease of sexual intentions within him does not look forward to more. So this lady, she responded to Rasulullah ﷺ as like a sharp sword. And then he stretched his hand to put it on her to calm her down. And she said, she answers back to them, to him, just like Miriam answered back to Jibreel when he turned to, as a man. And he said, إني أعوذ بالرحمن منك إن كنت تقيا. I seek refuge in Allah from you if you are someone who fears Allah. And this woman gives the same coin to Rasulullah. And then Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم says to her, قَدْ عُذْتِ بِمَعَاذِ. You have sought refuge with one who gives refuge, that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he came out to these two men that were with him, and he said to them, يَا أَبَا أُسَيْدٍ. أَبَا أُسَيْدٍ was the name of the man. أُكْسُهَا رَازِقَيْتَيْنِ. Give her two garments with white linen and send her back to her family. As you can see, this is another attack on our Prophet ﷺ, and this insult is in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Ahmad, and as I said, Tabaqat Ibn Sa'd, and Al-Imam Al-Hakim. An older hadith also by Al-Bukhari, 5637, and Sahal Ibn Sa'd, this is a completely different man, who is reported that ذُكِرَ لِلنَّبِي صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِمْرَأَةٌ مِنَ الْعَرَبِ. A mention was made to the Prophet ﷺ about a woman from the Arabs who was beautiful and extremely attractive. فَأَمَرَ أَبَا أُسَيْدٍ السَّاعِدِي أَنْ يُرْسِلَ إِلَيْهَا. So Rasulullah ﷺ ordered Abu Usaydin, the same man who went into the garden with him, that he would send for that lady. So Abu Usayd sent for her. فَقَدِمَتْ. So the lady came. فَنَزَلَتْ فِي أُجُمِّ بَنِي سَاعِدَةً. So she came down and she sat in a small fortress of Bani Sa'idah. فخرج النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم حتى جاءها. So the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم came out to meet her until he arrived to the place, and then فدخل عليها, and he entered upon her. فإذا امرأة منكسة رأسها. And what he saw there, he saw one woman with her head lowered. فلما كلمها النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قالت أعوذ بالله منك. So when the Prophet spoke to her, she said, I seek refuge in Allah from you. And then he said, you have sought refuge from the one who gives refuge. And then he said, you can leave to your parents. Later on, they told to her, أَتَدْرِينَ مَنْ هَذَا. Do you know who this man is? She said, no. They said, that is Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم, who came to seek your hand. And then she said, I am the most despicable woman and the most stressed, distressed. And you can put all the negativities in there. So the hadith again. When Rasulullah ﷺ sent for this woman to come to him, did the messenger say to her, Rasulullah, or did he say, oh, a man is asking you. This lady just answered, a man wants to speak to you. And she left her member of the family, because when she said, I am a queen, she is of noble status. And when Rasulullah ﷺ heard from her, she already is beautiful and her status is high. Would a woman, a queen, as she described herself, leave her home where she lived, Because a man wants to see her, and when she goes there, the man goes to her without even introducing himself, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, to her, asks her to surrender to him, and she said no, and then people said, oh, do you know who that is? No, actually, I didn't know. Who was it? Was Rasulullah. Oh my God. Where was it? Come on, guys. How much can they play with the mind of a Muslim? But sadly so, every man of religion out there knows this story, and this story is active at the core of everything they say and do and behave. A woman to them is surrender yourself up to me. That's all, the surrender yourself up to me. This is why the act of marriage, whenever they speak about it, is always a matter of the woman surrendering to the man, and as a result of that surrendering comes the problem of obedience. Because once a woman surrenders to a man, it means she obeys him unconditionally. If he wants to sleep with her sexually, he can sleep with her sexually no matter what. It doesn't matter how she feels emotionally, sexually, is she aroused, is she not, is she sick, she's not, it doesn't matter. I don't think Rasulullah is so thick. Any man out there who claims to be a man and doesn't understand the psychology of a woman is not eligible to marry. If you don't know how women think, how they feel, and how they are, you are not a man. If you don't understand the psychological, the sexual needs of a woman, and this is about an ordinary man. When Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who is rahmatul lil alamin, he is a mercy to everything that exists, a mercy. Do you think a woman who is busy cooking, her mind is completely in cooking so that the food doesn't burn? The husband would command the woman that if your husband comes from outside, all sexually aroused, all you have to do is drop that thing there, go get naked, open your legs, and that's it? Would Rasulullah say that nonsense? I wouldn't say it. Nobody would say it, nobody out there. But it looks like our Messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the mercy to mankind, to everything that exists, would command that. And the scholars lean on such stupid stories that are in Al-Bukhari and Muslim. And for your information, what is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim is not a religion, even though the scholars, the men of religion, have built a religion upon it. What is in Al-Quran is a religion. What is in Al-Bukhari and Muslim are probabilities, and they should stay where they do stay. As you can see, in that website, on the QA website, when you go there, he will tell you, اختلف العلماء. As usual, the scholars always are of different views as to who was that woman. And when you read that, there are seven different views with different stories that have happened. And all these stories are an insult to Rasulullah. I personally wouldn't want anyone to spread around in the community here in London or worldwide, wherever that is, that I went, had two brothers wait for me outside, and I walked into a room where there was a single, beautiful, high-status woman. And what did I ask of her? Straight away, surrender yourself to me. She said, no. And then I stretched my hand to touch her, to calm her down. I wouldn't want people to stretch this stupid story about me. Why is it this story in Al-Bukhari, Muslim, Ahmed, and so on and so forth? Because of the ridiculousness of this issue of the hadith. That once it's hadith, it has become like it's Allah sent from heavens, when we know it is not. Anyway, there is a third point, my dear sisters and my brothers. The scholars have, as usual, wanted to justify this story. Because in the website of Q&A and other variety of websites out there, they always start their statement by saying, this story is authentic, it has happened, and it is as it is. You know what? If I don't blame people for not coming to Islam. The man goes to a woman and tells her, what is this different? How is this different from a rape? A man goes to a woman to rape her. What do you think? He will start to reason with her. When she says no, he will push to action. So Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in our context, has pushed to rape a woman? Surrender yourself to me. When she said no, he stretched his hand to touch her? Na'udhu billah. Now, أعوذ بالله, yet the big shot scholars of Saudi Arabia, the Wahhabi and the Salafi today, ask any Salafi, he will tell you the story is true. They can't link it with the damage that it will cost to us and the future generations that are more savvy, more intellectual, more intelligent than any generations that have lived before. Because a rape is a rape. It's not who makes it that makes it a rape or not. It's the act itself. Is the act itself. Listen to this one. The scholars ask a question. لِمَاذَا اسْتَعَادَتِ الْمَرَأَةِ Why did the Joni woman, this lady here, why did she seek refuge from Allah? Now, they tried to paste this and then ended up blinding it completely. They say, they can say, قَدْ يُقَالْ It is said that what happened was, when this woman was going to get married, they say the reason she sought refuge with Allah from the Prophet is that some of the wives, and this is Aisha and Hafsa, because they were in the same party. So some of his wives, and in another books of hadith, they mentioned to Aisha, our mother Aisha. And in this story here, they will make our mother Aisha as a big liar, a very nasty, treacherous woman. Look at how they said that. They said some of his wives played a trick on her. How can you play a trick when you are wife of a prophet? They said by making her think that the prophet would like these words. This is an unbelievable thing. So what they're saying is that Aisha, our mother Aisha, Allah be pleased with her, and other wives of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, Hafsa and so on, they went to this woman, to this cute, sexy woman who high status and everything, because they were jealous of her. And for your information, in Islam, and I will deal this, inshallah, in an underlying reason, where when a woman is, because they justify all what our mother Aisha did that was wrong, un-Islamic, unaccepted, but it's there, it's documented, they always put it under the category of jealousy. And when the woman is jealous, she is allowed to do certain things that are not acceptable in Islam. This is what they say in our books of fiqh. As if on the day of judgment, why did you do that? I was jealous. Oh, okay, no problem. Give her a hasana, which is absolutely nonsense. Go back to our story. They say, they went to this woman, to a Joni woman, and they told her, Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam loves it when he comes to you, you say, A'udhu billah mink. Subhanallah al-azim. How, this woman, was she stupid? When she's a queen of high status, doesn't she understand أعوذ بالله منك what it means? My cat understands it. Well, not really, but it's figuratively speaking. So they would go to her and they would tell her, oh, by the way, if you want Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if you want to endear yourself to him, all you have to do is say أعوذ بالله منك and Rasulullah will love you even more. What a bunch of nonsense. This is how much they treat the brain of a Muslim as nothing, as a stupid thing. That's it. It's like a container. They pour into us whatever they want, and we have to accept it. As if she did not realize that the Prophet ﷺ would give her, they say, she didn't, they just told her that, and they didn't tell her that Rasulullah ﷺ would set her free. And this is reported by three different a hadith with different chain of narrators. One of them is in the levels, tabaqat of Bani Sa'd, or the classes of Bani Sa'd, and this is on volume 8, page 143 till 148, where he explains this nonsense. Also, and Al-Hakim in his Al-Mustadrik. And as I said, Al-Mustadrik or Mustadrik, this Al-Hakim is a scholar who looked at the hadith that fulfill the conditions of Bukhari and Muslim, but both of them did not put them in their books, so he created a completely third act of a hadith. And I will get to these things in future. But my dear sisters and my brothers, why I tell you this? Every scholar out there has derived, there are some books that derive some teachings from this horrible story. And they act on this because Rasulullah ﷺ said that, then that's it. This is why in the acts of marriage, they always tell the man offers, the woman is offered, and the man accepts. In the way they set our acts of marriage is they tell you the man, the woman is, I offer you my daughter as marriage, and the man says, I accept. And another insult. Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in one of the versions is married. So he divorced her and said, the other one, he heard of her, bring her to me. And the other one, she was in the garden. Which of these versions are we going to believe? They're all contradictory. They're all, it's like the cat ate the meat. No, the cat didn't eat the meat. Actually, the cat had some chicken. No, it was a fish. No, the cat was actually carrying some bread. Yes, we know the cat carried something, but the difference of views about what has happened exactly makes this story redundant, and it must be removed from Sahih, this Al-Bukhari. And enough lies about Al-Bukhari that it's the most authentic book after the book of Allah. The book of Allah says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Allah says, you have the most highest standard of character that a human being can have. And who says this? It's not me. It is Allah. It's impossible that Allah would put his man, his last messenger, in a very dodgy situation where he would walk onto a woman, offer yourself to me, surrender yourself to me, puts his hand on a stranger woman, and then what happens, Ya Rasulullah, when you said that when a man and woman are together, the third shaitan, and a man, if he touches another woman, is like digging a big needle in his head, even though this hadith is nonsense, but I'll get back to it later on, inshallah. But what happened to all these teachings? What happened that he turned his face from a man, or will he tell us to do something and he does the opposite? All this, my sisters and my brother, I am 100% sure that Al-Bukhari didn't put this story. And as I said before, we do not have the original copy of Al-Bukhari with us. So how can I really prove that this story is from Al-Bukhari, honestly and truly? Or has it been added by some dodgy hands that wanted to insult Rasulullah throughout history and they couldn't get straight through to him, so they fabricated some stories? Food for thought. But the problem is, our man of religion, not scholars, our man of religion, the copy-paste people, it doesn't matter who they are, they only do what? Listen to this kind of nonsense stories and build Islamic rulings based on these things. And this is why today in the Muslim world, women are living hell of a life. A Muslim woman, when she marries, she's doing what? That's it, she can't go out, so it means she's going to get fat. She can't go out, it means she's going to get unhealthy. And all her job is to do what? Cook for the man and be ready for him to jump on her whenever he so desires. Is this the final religion that Allah has sent to mankind? Is this Rabbul Alameen, the Lord of all the universes, that has sent a religion that brings peacefulness, beauty to all the universes, with a messenger that is sent to all the messengers, to all the universes, full of mercy to all? Does it make sense? I don't know. Sometimes I think I'm crazy. Wallahi al-Azim, sometimes I think I'm crazy to see these things as an insult when the rest of the world sees it as not. And if you go on Islam QA, he ends up this with an absolutely horrible thing. He says, this is what may be said about the reasons mentioned in the reports and in the words of the scholars about this story here. And then he says, all of it, all the nonsense that you have just said, points to the noble attitude of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because he did not want to marry somebody who he felt did not want him, and he refused to harm any of the Muslims either physically or financially. This is an absolutely nonsense. This is an absolutely nonsense. This is an attack, a direct attack on our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, an insult to him, insult to us, insult to Al-Bukhari, and insult to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to have sent a man like this who would go to a woman and says to her, surrender yourself to me. And when she rejects him, he stretches his hands to put it on her to calm her down. This, now you understand why our men of religion behave the way they do. It is because they lean on texts as a stupid idiot, nonsense, non-existence, and an attack on the honor of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as the one as I have mentioned. I pray to Allah this point here is clear, and I again will see you inshallah on the underlying reason number 2. This is again your brother Abdussalam Abu Hanifa. To join my group, please do send me a message on 078-76-40-87-35. all be blessed. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, and Allah bless you all.